2 Corinthians 5:16 says, therefore, one smart man says, if you ever read a therefore, it's encouraging. It would behoove you to find out why it's therefore. Therefore, from now on, we regard no man according to the flesh. 2 Corinthians 5:16. Did I not tell you that? 5:16. We regard no man according to the flesh, even though we are known Christ according to the flesh. Yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a old sinner saved by grace. What is he? New. Look at your neighbor, say new. Look to the neighbor that you neglected and say new. New. He's a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I'm going to read it this way. Old things went to goodwill. And all things are passed, and behold, all things become new. Now, all things are of God, who has been reconciled himself through Christ Jesus. And he has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses against them. Not holding, one version says, is the NLT, it says, not counting up their sins against them. Isn't that good news? God's not counting up your sins against you. He has committed us to the world of reconciliation. Verse 20. Now then, we are ambassadors of Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Listen to God. Come back to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. I'm going to speak to you on the subject of new versus old. New versus old. Title of tonight's message is what? Oh, you're awake? I'm going to ask you again. What's our title of tonight's message? New versus old. Let's pray. Father, I ask you tonight that we would again be reminded of Jesus, again be reminded of the cross, again get excited about the cross, again get excited about what you've done for us, and be reminded again that it's not our own righteousness, but it is your righteousness. Father, that we have been made right, been reconciled to God. Lord, that you took our sin upon you, and now we can stand free, clean, happy, healthy, whole, and enjoy our life. In Jesus' name, we love you so much. Lord, we thank you that every young person will get covered with shaving cream next week from head to toe. And it'll be a memorable experience. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. We've established, I like shopping, right? We've clarified that. I enjoy it. My wife does not allow me to shop for people's presents because I just buy myself something. In the process of getting them presents. It's like, well, I was at the store and I got my buddy a shirt for his birthday and I got myself 3 shirts because it's a good day. And so I like shopping and I particularly like newer things. Isn't it funny how a new pair of shoes can almost make you feel just a little happier? Is that just me? Makes you just step just a little bit, you know, peppier and makes you feel a new shirt or a new outfit. And it's funny that those new things slowly, how many guys in here, you get a new pair of shoes and you make sure that you walk wide so that you as not to scuff them together because, come on, how many have ever done that? Don't be shy, Tan. Never? Okay. And so you try not to scuff them. You avoid, you know, if you have an old cruddy pair of shoes, you walk right through the mud puddle. You're like, who cares? But if you get a new pair of shoes, you're like, oh, puddle. And you're like, walk around it. Anybody ever done that? You're like, oh, I don't want to damage these babies, right? And that lasts, maybe if you're cool and maybe if you're rich, maybe it lasts like a day. But me, it can last me a while because, like, I want to baby these things. And then there is this point that happens with your new stuff that all of a sudden you're like, puddle. And it usually happens kind of by accident. What happens with me and my shoes is, like, I'll go on a photo shoot, and I try to look decent when I work with clients, and so I'll dress kind of nice or whatever, and then we'll do a photo shoot, and I'm so committed to the photography and the things. Well, like, this happened just recently, and it was raining, and we were in this field, and the field looks cool, but I just walk through the field, and in the field there's mud and needles, and I look at my cool pair of shoes, and they're all like mud and needles, and all of a sudden it's like, those shoes are done, and I tell my wife, it's time for a new pair. I need some new shoes because daddy can't have dirty shoes. So I have about 4 or 5 pairs of shoes that are just kind of in my closet that I don't really wear anymore because they're dirty and they're old. And it's like, now I got to go get a new pair of shoes. They're like, they got holes in them or they got too many scuff marks. And it's funny how the new can become the old so quickly. I mean, a matter of months or maybe a year or maybe if you take care of your stuff too. But that which had the appeal doesn't have the appeal any longer. Maybe I'll give you this analogy. Maybe some of the guys can't relate to my shoe story. Maybe when you first get your brand new iPhone 3. You know what I mean? It's an iPhone 3, and it's way cooler than the iPhone 2. And for a year, you walk around with a pride. Anybody ever remember when the Razr was a cool phone? Anybody ever had the Razr? I had the Razr, and I remember feeling like Mission Impossible. Let me flip my phone for you. I flipped it all. Look, it's the keypad lights up. And it's color. It's color. You got that like green and blue phone, but mine's like color. It's like blue. I'm gonna blow your mind with my blue flip phone. And you know, it's so cool for like 3 months. And like you kind of proudly bring it out in front of people. Like, yeah, what's up? Flip my Razr phone out. Motorola. What? But then this game changer came in and it was an iPhone. You're like, wait a second, that's like good internet? I remember I got on the internet with my Motorola. Anybody ever do that? It's like a world that just goes around and around and around. Just going around, it's like, yeah, I'm on the internets right now. I could look stuff up. Want me to find your email? I could do it. It's like, that's about all you could do. And so, but then the iPhone comes out. It's like, you get the iPhone 3 and you're like, same thing. You're like, dude, check it out. iPhone. I got apps now. And it's like, and that lasts for about a year, you know. And then the new one comes here. I'm like, dude, I need the new one. My favorite was Jay Leno. No, it was Jimmy Fallon. He went out when the new iPhone 5 came out, and he got a bunch of iPhone 4s, and he went out into the streets of, I believe it was New York, wherever Jimmy Fallon is, and he started, and it's just an iPhone 4. And he's like, hey, we got the new iPhone 5, and we wanted to kind of demo it for everybody, and we wanted to show you what it does. And you know, so people are like grabbing this phone. It's an iPhone 4. And they're like, oh, wow, it's lighter? And they're like going through. It's like, dude, it's so much faster. One lady has her iPhone 4 in her hand, and she's like literally like, oh, man, it's so much different. Whoa, it's so clear. And it's like, oh, man, it's so much faster. I need to go get one right now. And I'm just like busting up laughing. And isn't that how it is, though? You know, isn't it where we're like, oh, new. And it doesn't take but like 4 months for that which we had was new is now old because of scuffs, because of cracks, because of damage that has happened to it. Or just because of time, we think inevitably time makes something of less value. And I want to challenge us tonight, if we're not careful, we can begin our relationship with God in this place of I'm constantly needing to upgrade, and I'm not, I am a new creation, but I need to keep on working to get good with Him. And I need to keep on trying because otherwise God's not happy with me. And I got to keep, I mean, I got to get my new software update. And man, if I don't do just right, and I want to challenge you tonight that God's righteousness, He made you a new creation, period. That's it. End of story. You're right with God. You have been reconciled with God. That word reconciled means you have been made right. You no longer have any problem with each other. It's a mutual fixing. It's a mending. And Jesus did that for you when you were a sinner, when you were helpless, when you could do nothing on your own, when you could not reciprocate that love. His love for you is that way. It's not practical. It's not rational. Guys, we don't even, it's like the, I've heard this analogy. It's like the girls who think they're going to marry Justin Bieber. It's like, no. First off, you're like 14. That's illegal. Second of all, he doesn't know your name. He doesn't even know who you are. It's crazy. But nonetheless, they want to continue this love affair with him. It's crazy. It's silly. It's not even, and that's kind of how Jesus is for the world. Do you realize that Jesus loves sinners? Do we really fathom that? Do you realize that Jesus loves people who will never love him back? Like, think about that. And we get chips on our shoulder towards people. It was funny, when I was working the Max ministry, 6 years ago now, it's been forever, but we talked to people, and one of the lines that we would ask people right away says, do you consider yourself a good person? And how many guys know that everybody considers themselves a good person? But every one of us at the same time, we are our toughest critics, and we think that we're the worst people, really, inwardly. And I want to challenge us tonight on righteousness and what that really means. You are right with God, period, not because of what you do. Now, we respond to that righteousness with our life. It's just like Paul was saying, just because that you have the grace of God, does that mean you piddle on it? Does that mean you just forget, can do anything you want? And he says, of course not. Of course not. Why would you? But I think too many times we don't think enough about God's righteousness, what he's done for us. We don't think, we're like, okay, I sinned yesterday, so now I've got to like, now I'm old, and I got to do like 10 prayers maybe and like live clean for like 10 days. And then I'm like, and then I might be new again. I've got to go for a while without sinning now. And if I go long enough without it, then I'm made righteous. And guys, your righteousness doesn't quit. Either Jesus paid it all or he didn't. Either he paid for your sin or he didn't. And imagine if we could have people who were confident towards God like we should be. What could we partake in if we walk? And that doesn't mean that we just go live any which way we want, but it does mean we march boldly to the throne of grace. And guys, what I'm trying to attack tonight is that time of you feeling bad. Those 4 days, those 10 days, those 20 days, that month, that year, where you're like, I sinned. You don't know what I did last summer. And you don't know what I'm going through, Pastor Nate. You don't know the sin that's dogging me. And I'm going to work myself right. I'm going to stop. I'm going to quit. And it's almost like you say, okay, I'm going to go get help as soon as I fix this. And young person, you are incapable of fixing anything. You cannot work your way to Jesus. You cannot work your way to righteousness. You are righteous now, and now we march up to the throne of grace, and we receive strength and find help in a time of need. You want to quit sinning? Hang out with Jesus. You want to quit sinning? Really? If you really want to stop sinning, you really want to get to a spot where you have a pure heart and no condemnation, what it says, those who are in Christ Jesus. Those who are in Christ Jesus, you find yourself in him. You find yourself excited about him. You take on his righteousness and you say, yeah, I have no business here. That is why we worship. That's why, like, it boggles my mind when on any worship day, you sit there, people, not you, other people sit there and don't lift their hands and don't engage their hearts. It's not a matter. I'm actually not a very demonstrative guy myself. You won't ever really probably find me going crazy and spinning like Sandrina. You won't. I'm not that particular kind of person. But I love Jesus, and one thing you will not catch me doing at a worship service is just sitting there. Jesus has done too much for me to sit there. Jesus has done too much for me to just barely mum the song words. My favorite thing to do, if you've ever watched me, is to just close my eyes, not even sing the song, and just begin to thank God for everything he's done for me. But remind myself of the blood of Jesus. One thing I do daily, I say, Father, I thank you for the blood of Jesus. I thank you for the cross. I put myself in remembrance of what Jesus did for me. And Father, I know that you are not counting up my sins against me. Think about that. He's not like, whoa, Jordan. Nuh-uh. You don't come to me yet. Fix yourself. Then you can come. Nope, you still stink of sin. Go clean up. Go clean up first. Change your attitude first, and then you come to me. Because young people, if we're not careful like that, what we do is we stay away. And the strength that you need to change is with him. We're like, yeah, I'm going to clean up. No, you won't. You can't fight it on your own. You can't just be good. It's not just I'm just going to try real hard. Great, that might last 6 months. But what about the next test? What about the next obstacle? How are you really going to do it? The Bible says, I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Your only strength is Jesus. Your only strength is communion with him, fellowship with him. And when you break that fellowship through sin and you stay away, there's no hope. There's no strength. There's no fighting. There's no great ability awaiting you. But I tell you, you tap in. You begin to press into God. You say, God, I might be dealing with this, but I come boldly to your throne. I don't come in on my own righteousness. But I come in on yours. Great things await you. Look at this. I want you to see some scripture tonight. We got a lot, and I'm going to wrap up, and I'm going to close this thing in 10 minutes. Ephesians 2, chapter 2, verse 1. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. Isn't that good news? You used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our own sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger. You know God has anger? Yeah, he does. Just like everyone else. Verse 4, But God, who is rich in mercy, he so loved us that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace you have been saved, for he raised us from the dead along with Christ, and he seated us with him in heavenly places. Have you ever thought about that? The devil will say, you keep working your way. You keep working. You'll get to heaven. Work hard enough. Keep doing right. There you'll get there. But you do wrong, you're out. Where are you seated? Where are you seated? We just read it. Okay, this is deep. Let's read it again. God, for he raised us. Who's us? That's you. From the dead, along with Christ, and he seated us with him in heavenly places because we are united with Christ. So God can point to us and to all future ages as an example of his incredible wealth of his grace, kindness towards us, as he showed in all who has done for us who's united with Christ. Verse 8, God saved you by his grace when you believed. You can't take credit for this. It's a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward from the good things we have done. Please understand that. We get working our way to Jesus. We get that. It's like, okay, I was good for a week. I deserve Jesus. I deserve the cross. Okay, I deserved it. That is no different than Sydney coming up to me one day and be like, Dad, I did it. I've now been good enough to deserve your love. And I eat this cereal because I deserve it. No, I brought you into this world. It was me. I give you food, period. You know what's crazy too? Is I'm never going to quit loving Sydney. I don't care if she turns into the biggest prisoner in the world. Will I be mad at her? Absolutely. Will I not have fellowship with her? Absolutely. Will I potentially watch her screw her life up? Which she's not going to do. Mind my heart. Mind what I'm saying. But will my love for her ever change? Absolutely not. Not at all. It won't even. I don't care if she was in prison for 40 years. And the next time I saw her, I'd wrap my arms around her. Love her with all my heart. That is God's love for you. And really, I encourage you all, once you get married, to have children. Because you begin to, you get it. I shouldn't say you get it, because really, I don't think we do get it. But you like, especially when they're larvae and they're sitting there and they're puking on you and they're pooping on you. Sydney or Kinsey peed on me twice. You pee on me, I'm going to punch you in the nose. Okay? I will not be your friend for like a good week if you pee on me. I promise you that. We won't even talk. But you know what I did with Kenzie when she peed on me? Oh, baby, it's all right. I love you. I tickled her right after. I was like, it's all right, baby. That is God's love for you. We don't get it. Why would you thumb your nose at that? Why would you say, forget you, God, I don't want to know you? Why would you say, oh, I have to read my Bible? Do you remember what he did for you? Do you remember how good he's been to you? Why would you not, oh, I got to go pray. I got to go to church. Huh? You were dead and now you're alive. Doesn't get old. Doesn't get boring. Doesn't rub off and it doesn't get old. Keep going. God saved you by his grace. Salvation is not a reward of the good things you've done. So none of us can boast. Verse 10, we are his masterpiece, created as anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do good things he planned for us to do a long time ago. Ephesians, flip over just two more chapters, Ephesians 4. It says, look at this. I just love this. It says, with the Lord's authority, I say to you, live no longer as Gentiles do, for they are hopelessly confused. Don't live like all the rest of your friends, okay? Their minds are full of darkness. They wander far from the life of God, which gives them because they close their minds and they harden their hearts against him. They have no sense of shame. They live for lustful pleasure and eagerly practice every kind of impurity. That's your high school hallways. That's your junior highs. I guarantee it. Keep going. Since you've heard about Jesus and learned of the truth that comes from him, throw off your old sinful nature and your former ways. Throw that old stuff off, which is corrupted by lust and deception. Instead, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes and put on that new nature. You know what's cool about that new nature? Kind of like what I up to? It doesn't get old. That righteousness doesn't get old, doesn't wear off. And that feeling like that new pair of shoes or the new phone, it's always up to date. It's always making you feel good. It's always like, look what I got. I got his righteousness. It's new, it's fresh, it's relevant, and I pull it out with excitement because look at me, I got it. But I'm not really boasting on it because it's him who gave it to me. Keep going. Verse 28, if you are a thief, quit stealing. Instead, use your hands for good work. Get a job. And then give generously to others in need. Don't use, look at this, why can't I cuss, Pastor? Now I want to cuss. Shut up. Don't use foul or abusive language. You know that cussing is stupid. Okay, keep going. I was going to say something else. Let everything be good and helpful so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. Listen, if you're listening to music that's F this and F that, F bomb that, you're carnal. Keep going. Verse 30, and do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Do you know that you can grieve the Holy Ghost? You can hurt him? If Sydney, 16 years old, goes and robs a bank, you know what it's going to do to me? It's going to grieve me. Will I love her? Absolutely. Will I be there for her? Absolutely. Will I hug her neck? Absolutely. But there'll be a grieving in my heart for her. That's exactly your relationship with God. Can you do everything you want? Yeah. You want to smoke weed? Go smoke weed, man. Have at it. You want to go get a boyfriend, get a girlfriend when your parents tell you? Yeah, go for it. But you're grieving the Holy Ghost. Will he still love you? Yeah. Will he hug you? Yeah. Will you still be righteous in his eyes? Yeah. Will you lose your fellowship? Yeah. And the wages of sin is still death. You work for sin, you will get a paycheck of death. Period. Verse 31, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words. Listen, I'm not looking at anybody. You do not flip out. If you're really a Christian, you don't flip out. You don't have fits of rage in your bedroom. You don't flip your mom off when the door is closed. You don't lie. You don't use harsh words, slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Instead, you got to be kind to one another. Tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God forgave you. We got to land this thing. But young people, my challenge for you tonight, don't let a span of time pass and you don't get right with God. You screw up, you run right away to God. Say, man, God, help me. I didn't mean to do that. I got caught up. I went stupid. I did, you know, I looked at, I watched that movie. I whatever man, I shouldn't have said that. Be quick to get right with God. Be quick to admit your sin. Be quick to be like, whoa. It's not that, it's the power of confession. It's the power of just turning and repentance. Lord, help me. I'm not trying to run from you. Instead of this like awkward moment where you like have 4 days in between, you come to church, you don't raise your hands because you're feeling bad and all that crap. Because why I say that is we live so below. We're like, okay, I feel good. Oh, I sinned again. I feel good. Oh, I sinned again. While there's like all this above that where we should be living. That's my challenge to you tonight. New versus old. Remember, when you put on righteousness, it doesn't get old, doesn't wear out, doesn't get outdated. It wasn't yours in the beginning, and you put it on happily, and you show everybody what you got. You're not boasting, but you're just grateful, and you're walking in that grace. Don't allow yourself to have those days of long sin where you don't confess, and you don't talk to him, and you don't. Every time you miss it, you run to him. You say, Father, help me. God, I missed it. I want to keep my heart right. Lord, I know that nothing's going to take me from your love, but Lord, forgive me. I don't want to grieve you. I don't want to do wrong. I want to do that which you called me to do. I promise you, you live that way, you'll thrive. You'll find that next time you face that situation, grace will be there, and you'll fight, and you're like, man, I won. And you keep your mind on Jesus. You keep your fellowship with Jesus. Sin begins to be a thing of the past. You won't fight the same demons you fought this year as you did next year. Why? Because those things fall off as you lift Jesus up in your life. Promise. Let's pray. Father, thank you. We love you. Some of you young people right now, every head bowed, every eye closed, you need to get right with God. You have been in that lull state. You've been in that state that vexed in between, you know? You know you did something stupid, but you also know that God loves you, but you don't know how to come back to him. And I'm not talking about losing your salvation. I'm just talking about your fellowship. You're at a place of just there. I don't know. And I want to challenge you tonight. I'm not going to make you raise your hand. I'm not going to make you come up in front of anybody. Please get right with God. Please be reconciled to your Father. Please just turn around and change your heart. It's not even a matter of fixing everything right now, this moment, this time. It's just a matter of saying, God, I come back. I need your help. I can't do this on my own. Can't do this on my own merit, but Father, I receive your righteousness. I receive that reconciliation. Everybody say this with me. Say, Father, help me. I'm trying to live for you, I'm not trying to run away from you. Help me be quick to run to you. Help me not miss it. Lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from the evil one. I'm completely yours. My mind, my will, my emotions, my spirit, my life is yours. Have your way in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I love you so much. How many guys were benefited from that tonight? How many guys say, yeah, Pastor Nate, I've been there. And listen, I don't just pick messages out of the sky. I really don't. I try to, generally the way it works is about Thursday and Friday, tomorrow, even in my midst of my busyness, I have my one ear to my belly. You know what I mean by that? Just one ear to my spirit. And I'm saying, I'm just kind of listening and I'm just, Lord, what's the plan? Where are we going on Wednesday? Sometimes it won't even be till Wednesday where I actually sit down and pen it out. But I believe if you come in every single week, God, I need this or I want this. Don't just take a shovel to church and just, oh, yeah, my cousin Sam, he needed this. Well, cousin Sam ain't here. You here. And obviously this is something you could work on or you may be working on or you maybe have worked on or you need to work on. Amen.